bit of background on Fisher & Paykel Healthcare. We are the global leader in respiratory humidification devices. We are listed on the New Zealand Stock Exchange and the Australian Stock Exchange. We're headquartered in New Zealand with the headquarters there, all of our R&D done in New Zealand, and the majority of our manufacturing done in New Zealand. We have over 50 years of experience in changing clinical practice to improve outcomes for patients. And I just want to spend a bit of time talking through what changing clinical practice involves. It's a long, slow process, and it's never really ever complete and done. And we never say we're finished with change of clinical practice, let's move on. However, it does have its own rhythm in terms of the growth driver that it provides to the business as we work through the cycle of changing clinical practice. The first part of changing clinical practice is to get the clinical evidence and the data and one, do all the clinical trials and get that information to prove that this new therapy is beneficial to patients and will improve their outcomes. And explaining that to the physicians, the clinicians who are actually the ones delivering the therapy to the patients. The next one is to get that physician to actually purchase the equipment to be able to deliver that therapy. And then the third part is to have them use it on all the patients that could benefit from that therapy. And that means changing the practice of them and their teams from what they've traditionally done to this new therapy that they've not done, not used before. So it is quite a long, slow process and does take time and significant investment from the sales team to work through that. And our sales team have to be very clinically minded to be able to talk through all of that evidence. We invest significantly in R&D to ensure that we continue to improve our products, continue to develop new therapies, better therapies to really improve the outcomes for the patients. So with that significant R&D investment, which keeps us at the forefront of technology, as well as the forefront of the therapy within the business, within the industry, combine that with the fact that we are in medical devices, we manufacture medical devices and the regulation around medical devices, and we are the global leader in these respiratory devices, there's a very high barrier of entry for any other company to come in to that market. We have a very global business. Whilst we're headquartered in New Zealand, about 99% of our revenue is offshore. If you think about it, it sort of follows the population and who needs respiratory support. The sales sort of follow population along that regard. We have over 7,000 people globally, and they are located in over 50 countries around the world. However, more than half of those people are based in New Zealand. As I said, we've got our headquarters in New Zealand, R&D done in New Zealand, and a lot of the manufacturing done in New Zealand. We have very strong financial performance, and I'll touch on that in later slides. So just to talk through a little bit about what our business does and what respiratory support is. We have significant organic long-term growth opportunities within our business. When we look at the potential market based on the therapies that we currently provide today and the clinical evidence that we have today, we estimate that our total addressable market opportunity is over 25 billion New Zealand dollars. To put that in context, our revenue for financial year 22, which we just went out last month to the market to release, was $1.7 billion of revenue. Our business is split into two categories. We have the hospital category and the home care category. The hospital category are those acute patients who there's something acute that's happened to them, they have to go into hospital, or they've been in hospital for something, and then they need respiratory support coming out of a surgery or something like that. Then the home care side are more the chronic patients with obstructive sleep apnea, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, where they're chronic, they're living with these conditions every day, and may or may not get acute and need to be hospitalised. Prior to COVID, around about 60% of our revenue came from the hospital segment and about 40% through home care. COVID has provided a bit of a disruptor during the period of COVID through the pandemic to our business, and I will talk about that a little bit more later. But just touching on the various therapies in hospital, we provide products across the whole range of respiratory support within the hospital. And that, again, is one of our big competitive advantages, being across all of those therapies. The first one is invasive ventilation, where a patient cannot breathe on their own. So they're in intensive care and they're hooked up to a ventilator, and the ventilator is breathing for them. We then have non-invasive ventilation, where the patient is spontaneously breathing, but they still do need quite a lot of support with that, with their respiration. We then have hospital respiratory support, which is also called nasal high flow. A lot of you will have heard of that now through COVID. It certainly has had a spotlight shone on it through COVID as one of the main treatments for patients in hospital with COVID. We also call that OptiFlow, so hospital respiratory support, nasal high flow, or OptiFlow is really that category. And then we also have the surgical part of the business, where we use our expertise in humidification to assist in surgeries. So it's not respiratory support, but it's assisting surgical procedures by the use of humidification. And then in the home care side, we have the home respiratory support, which is our nasal high flow that we spoke about in the hospital, but it's in the home to treat those chronic patients. And then we have the obstructive sleep apnea part of the business, where people stop breathing when they're asleep, and so they need that humidified support, that constant flow of air and pressure to help keep their airways open and stop those apneas. With all of these therapies, there's really two components to it. The first part is the hardware or the device, and you need to have the device to be able to deliver the therapy. And then we have what we call the consumables, or our recurring revenue, which is the per patient set of consumables that goes from the device, from the hardware, transports that humidified gas to the patient. And then in most of these therapies, we also provide the interface for the patient, either the nasal cannula or the mask, to deliver that therapy to the patient. And traditionally, around about 85%, give or take, of our revenue has been that consumable, that recurring revenue for patients. Moving on, I just sort of want to talk through how we were looking at our business prior to COVID-19. We started off in the intensive care area with that invasive ventilation, and that was our change of clinical practice, and that drove our growth for a couple of decades. Around the late 90s, we moved into obstructive sleep apnea, and that really then drove the growth over those next few decades. And what we're trying to show on this graphic is that when we're in that sweet spot of changing clinical practice and getting some real strong momentum, that's the key growth driver of our business. But then it continues to grow. And so when we start into obstructive sleep apnea, the intensive care respiratory support still keeps growing, But it's then the OSA that is the key driver there. In the last decade or so, the primary driver has been the hospital respiratory support and the nasal high flow part of our business. And that's sort of where we're in the middle of at the moment. We anticipate that the home respiratory support will be the next primary driver in our medium term. And then once that has been really well penetrated, we will have global distribution throughout the hospital. We'll have global distribution through home care. And so then the next one we'll be looking at is surgical. So we need to be starting that now. What COVID has done for us is really provided an acceleration of the hardware placement. And as I said, the hardware is what's needed to deliver the therapies. This graph shows our strong growth as a business since our inception. So for the last 10 years, our revenue compound annual growth rate's 12.5% and our net profit after tax, 19%. In the last 2 years, we've sold effectively 10 years worth of hardware due to that COVID-driven demand, where hospitals were overrun with COVID patients and they needed to be able to provide therapy. So they were purchasing big orders of hardware. So we have a very strong compound annual growth in our business, and we will be continuing to invest in that to ensure that we take advantage and make the most of that opportunity of having the hardware out in the business. Our philosophy is to, with the cash, we're a strong cash generating business, with the cash that we do generate, invest first and foremost in the business, in our R&D to ensure that we've got that product pipeline of products coming down the track. And for us, sort of short term is less than 10 to 15 years, long term is 20 plus years. So our timeframes of what we think about long term and short term are quite different to a number of other companies around there. So we're investing today knowing that in 20 years' time, we want something to become materially the growth factor for our business. So we invest in our business, in our R&D, in our sales team to ensure that we're supporting the hardware that's been placed through COVID and to continue that change of clinical practice. And then in our infrastructure, our plant and equipment, and then our land and buildings. And then we return money back to shareholders, and we've got a strong track record of progressive dividend payments, which we're very proud of to our shareholders. So with that little bump of COVID, we then have adapted that graphic that I spoke about before to show this sort of boost that COVID has done at the moment. Now, this isn't to scale. We can't say exactly where we are on that bump of COVID, but what it absolutely has done is accelerated the placement of hardware and given us a wonderful opportunity to advance our longer term plans. So what we're wanting to do is accelerate our home respiratory support and get that material a bit earlier, as well as our surgical technologies. And one aspect of our business that we've just been talking about more recently at this last earnings release is our anaesthesia opportunity, which is, as a therapy, it's in the hospital respiratory support. It is that nasal high flow supporting patients when they're under anaesthetic. But in terms of the call point or the sales team, it's in that surgical area of the hospital. So we have piloted a dedicated sales force to work on that. And we don't see any change to our aspirations. We are continuing that growth to sustainably double in size every 5 to 6 years.